Greetings, everyone. Welcome to the last director Q&A session of the Taiwan Post-New Wave Cinema series. I'm Bi Yu Zhang, the Deputy Director of the Center of Taiwan Studies. It is our pleasure to welcome Director Cheng Yu-Chieh today, one of the most important younger generation filmmakers in Taiwan. This week, we screen one of his earliest work, Summer Dream, 时定的夏天, and also some of his most important feature films, such as Do-Over, 一年之初, Yang Yang, and the first episode of his TV series, Days We Stare at the Sun, 他们在毕业的前一天爆炸. Moreover, we really love his work, Wawa no Sido, 太阳的孩子, and it had been screened three times in the last 3 years at SOAS. On Wednesday, Dr. Christopher Brown analyzed Zheng's films brilliantly. We learned a lot about his stylistic versatility, his emphasis on this kind of performance, and also the use of handheld camera, not to mention the critical approach that he in his films towards identity, both personal and national. Today, you have the opportunity to ask him further questions. I'm sure there are plenty to follow. As usual, I would like to thank our funder, the Ministry of Culture Taiwan, and the Culture Division at the Taipei Representative Office in the UK, and also express our gratitude to the assistance of the Taiwan Film Institute. Without their generous support, it would not have been possible for us to launch such an ambitious project. Please be aware this session is recorded. I would appreciate it if you could turn off your audio and video functions and to enhance the quality of the session. To ask questions, please post it in the chat column you can find on the top. It is open now. So could you please pose only one question at a time, at least, and keep them succinct? Our assistant curator, Shaoyi, will then collate the questions and present them to the director. So to start off this Q&A session, Director Zheng would like to say a few words. So Yu-Chieh, over to you.
Okay. Hello, everyone. 很高兴能有这个机会，跟大家做这个专题的座谈交流。
Hello, I'm glad to have the opportunity to speak to everyone and interact with all of you on this topic of post-new wave cinema.
这一次大家看的作品是我的比较早期的作品。
So this time, the films that we have in this series are mostly from my earlier work.
在这里面最新的作品可能是他们在毕业的前一天爆炸，第二季。
Probably the latest work from these films is the second season of Days We Stared at the Sun.
这部作品算是我最后一部年轻的作品。So
this particular work is probably the last work, the last one of my young work.
Dear Tainan, 是亲爱的房客。那这部作品跟以往的作品有比较大的区别。那 最大的差别在于，之前的作品可能 我会比较比较多很直白的情绪。
So my latest work, which is called Dear Tenant, and it is currently screening in Taiwan. And this work is a little bit different from my previous work. And the biggest difference is perhaps is that in my previous work, they tend to convey a more straightforward emotion.
在新的作品里面，在 Dear Tenant 里面，所有表达的情绪变得比较含蓄。
But in Dear Tenant, all the emotions become a bit more subtle and perhaps a little bit ambivalent.
所以，在看之前的作品，对现在的我来讲，有一点像是在翻我年轻的时候的照相簿。
So when I look back on these earlier works of mine, it feels a little bit like revisiting my old photo album.
可能还不是很成熟，不是很完整，但是那个时候有那个时候的美丽。那希望可以跟大家多一些交流分享。
So these earlier works might not be that mature, but they do have there's a unique beauty to these old works, and I'm happy to share my feeling with the audience.
谢谢 ，Thank you.
Brilliant. Thank you very much. As the host or the chair of this session, I think I got the privilege, I was given the privilege to ask the first sets of questions. So, Youjie, I'm going to ask in Chinese first, then I'll translate it into English first. Then Xiaoyu will come in to also help you. Okay, thank you. Okay. 第一个问题是，我对于一年之初感到非常惊艳。这故事的结构跟时空的交织是非常特别的。那么手持镜头的这种大量的运用啊，以及许多长镜头，这在那个时候至少一般的台湾电影里头不是很常见的。那么由于一年之初是你第一部剧情长片，那么你虽然不是电影科系出身的，那我就觉得很好奇的是你的电影美学跟技巧是怎么样发展出来的。 OK, can I now you think about it, then I'll translate. I was quite struck by do-over. For example, the interweaving of the five storylines, the long close-ups,and also the use of handheld camera technique, they have all given this film a kind of urgency or intensity and instability. So although this is your first full-length feature film, Do-Over doesn't look like a film that made by a new director. I wonder how you develop your own cinematic aesthetics as well as techniques,since your background was in economics, not trained in filmmaking.
我的电影的养分很多都是从好莱坞电影或者是一些影展电影而来的。例如说，我那个时候可能特别喜欢像 Pulp Fiction 这样子的电影。然后受到一些影响。
I always look to Hollywood films and the film festival films for inspiration. And at a point, I was pretty interested in Pulp Fiction, and so that probably also influenced my stylistic.
那就是因为 台湾的电影，在世界上大家对于台湾的电影有一个既定的印象。那身为那个时候年轻的导演，要拍出第一部作品，就会非常有企图心的想要去做出有别于以往的台湾电影的影像风格。
So at that time, I thought everyone has a very stereotypical impression of Taiwan cinema. So as a young filmmaker at that time, I wanted to make a difference and to set myself apart from this stereotype.
但是其实到了现在，其实这十五年来渐渐的，其实我又吸收了很多原来所谓的台湾新电影的养分，然后但是还是加入了自己的东西，所以其实我的东西变得比较混杂了各式各样的电影的来源。
However, in recent years, in around these 15 years, I've been learning and taking and I've been getting inspiration from Taiwan New Cinema. But I also add my own stuff and so it becomes more of a hybrid style with different elements and inspiration.
然后第一次拍片的很多东西都是直觉，然后影像风格我们的摄影师 Jake Pollock 给我们的那个影像风格是非常强大的，非常他在影像风格的主导性是非常强的。
你的意思是说他就是他在拍片的过程中他也就是用他自己的风格来主导的。
对，是。
了解。So when I made my film for the first time, a lot of decisions were instinctual, and also our cinematographer Jake Pollock has a very strong style of his own, and he also contributed a lot to the stylistic decision.
对，然后一年之初跟杨洋的摄影师都是 Jake Pollock。然后他是一个美国人，但现在算一半的台湾人，因为他太太是台湾人。
So Jake Pollock was the cinematographer for both Do Over and Yang Yang. He was an American, but now he's half Taiwan, and his wife is also Taiwanese.
Okay, 好，大概这样，谢谢。
Okay, thank you. I see quite a lot of questions already being posted, so I will leave mine to the last if we got time. Okay.
Okay, good.
So, Xiaoyu, would you like to take over? Thank you.
But I'm wondering if David and Wafa would like to post their own questions.
Can I unmute them? Okay. Maybe Wafa first.
Okay, hi.
Hi.
Hello, Director Cheng. I would like to know a little more about your actor's direction method. If you leave space for improvisation, and because you use a lot of long shots sometimes, I really would like to know how you work with your actors. Thank you.
Thank you. Do you want to know the method in my early work or in general?
In general, and if there was changes in the way you work.
Oh.
Oh. 对不起，我还是用中文好了。我有点怕我表达的不好，用英文的话。 OK， 我可以回答的吗？
Yeah， 可以，请说。可以啊。
OK， 我通常给演员会比较多空间，然后我因为我自己也是演员，那我喜欢的表演方式是，我的表演中间不要被中断。 所以我拍每一个镜头，我尽量让它是整场戏，就是从头走到尾。对，先这样回答。嗯，好，谢谢。
So, for me, I usually give more space, of improvisation to my actors, because I'm also an actor myself. So for me, my own preference is not to be interrupted. That's why I also, so usually I'll let them do a whole take or a whole sequence.
然后越到最近，尤其是像我最新拍的这个作品，我的准备工作 就会变成是越来越是在拍摄之前跟演员沟通好，一旦开拍之后，就大部分都交给演员。But
when it comes to my recent film, I usually do all the preparation before the shooting starts. So I'll communicate with the actors before the shooting happens. But once it starts, I'll let them take control over the acting.
然后在现场拍摄的时候，我不太喜欢排戏，但我会走位，然后走完位之后就会。 直接拍第一个 take， 然后通常我很喜欢用第一个 take， 所以第一个 take 大家都会非常的珍惜。So usually,
我在想走位怎么讲？I only do technical
rehearsal and the 那叫什么 blocking 吗？那个不是 blocking 那个走位，那个叫
it's a camera position no， it's a position of the camera no，
yeah, not
the position of the camera
and,
but the
Only we re, not an actor, and we only do it for a technical rehearsal. But after that, we shoot the first take. And usually, I cherish the first take very much because I think first take is always the best one. The most natural. So I cherish the first take. And, 我刚刚用英文。
Yes. Have you finished the
sometimes I shoot it as if I don't have second take, we usually do it a lot, but always the first take is always the best one.
Okay.
这样有回答问题吗?
I think so.
Is that okay?
Yeah.
Yeah, this is perfect.
Okay, thank you.
Does Stafford want to come forward?
Yeah, okay. Yeah, hi there.
Hey.
I wanted to ask about your short film, 潜规则.
Okay, good.
It's a film that I often show in my class, and the students always laugh a lot, and the discussion is really interesting. And even though it's a very short film, it creates a lot of different kind of topics. So I wondered whether you could talk a little bit about how you made this film. Did you start off with the ending? I'm just curious about the way you made this film.
Okay. It comes all at once. I mean, the whole story was there in my mind. It's already there, and I just wrote it out. And it's very how to say. It's very ironic because when I shot the short film Unwritten Rule, it was 2011, I guess. Yeah, 2011. And 2011, you know. At that time,中国的审查还在那个时间还没有那么严重，可以先帮我翻译这一句吗？
Oh, okay. So at that time, the censorship from mainland China was not as strict as nowadays.
但是我那个时候其实有猜测到。 10年后的今天会变成像现在这个样子.
But I had my doubts at that time, which is 10 years ago. So I was predicting more or less that it would probably become a lot more strict.
但是在那个时间点，我周围的 所有的人都不公开讨论这件事情，因为大家都非常的接受，就是例如说在内部短片里面看到，例如说我们会把自己的国旗藏起来，或者是避开一些中国不希望我们讲的一些词汇。But
at that time, no one would publicly discuss this kind of issue, and everyone kind of accepted this status quo, and for example, like hiding the flag and avoiding particular words or rhetoric.
那这让我觉得很奇怪，为什么没有人敢反抗，没有人敢，甚至是不要说反抗，没有人 愿意指出那个房间里面的大象.
So I felt very strange. So I wonder why no one ever resisted or even just points to the elephant in the room.
那是2011年的事情.
So that time it was 2011.
然后到了今年，或去年2019年、2020年，再回头看那部短片，会觉得非常的讽刺又很难过。对。And
now when I look back on this film, in 2019, it makes me feel very ironic and sad about the situation.
因为当我在拍的时候，我心里面其实有一个很天真，有一个想法是觉得说，如果十年后再看这部片，我们大家会觉得说郑有杰想太多了，那该有多好。
So when I was making that film in 2011, I had this naive thought that perhaps after 10 years we'll look back and just laugh at how Zheng Youjie has overthought about the matter. So, that will be a really great scenario.
但可惜不是。
But sadly, that isn't the case. 谢谢。
现在在台湾工作啊，只要背后的，就是例如说我们拍电影或我们演戏，那有的时候，这些规定已经不再是 unwritten rule， 它会写在合约里面，你必须要保证你的政治倾向是没有问题的，或者是你不做任何政治的宣誓。现在在某一些合约里面，它是 written rule， 它不是 unwritten。嗯。
So nowadays, when you work in Taiwan, for example, like making films or acting, in a lot of situations, these rules are no longer unwritten rules, but actually written in contracts. You have to make sure you won't make any political statement.
然后现在，对 ，Yeah， 就是这样。
你可以继续。
没有但现在其实就是大家也是不太会公开讨论，但其实大家都知道了，这个是算是一个大家都知道的事情了。然后。演艺圈的人不会公开讨论，但是演艺圈之外的人都大家都随时都在讨论。
Why?
因为大家都想要，第一个主要是一方面是不想要影响到自己未来的工作，再来是不希望影响到其他人，就是大家会觉得就是说这件事情不是只影响自己，而会影响到例如说跟我工作的其他人。所以在我们这个行业很少人会公开讨论。我知道除了我以外还有几个导演会讨论，像李慧仁导演，那郑文堂导演也算。但是其他的比较不会去讨论，对。那当然还有一些拍纪录片导演，像之前的拍，对，可能会去稍微可能会公开讨论的，就是比较少数。
So nowadays, everyone, no one openly talks about these issues, but actually, everyone knows about the situation, and especially people in the entertainment industry, they try to avoid these issues, even though everyone knows about it. The reason is that they don't want to affect their career, and they don't want to affect other people. And the people who work with them. So, apart from me, there's only a handful, few directors who address these issues in their work. There are also some documentary filmmakers who address these issues, but otherwise, everyone tends to keep quiet.
李慧仁导演有一个纪录片，就是 专门在讲这件事情，然后他应该叫那个字我不知道怎么念，那个字我不会念，但是对他有一部纪录片，在讲这件事情，对，在讲。
Yeah, we screened that film a couple of years ago. That was two years ago.
Which one?
Li Huiyan's film, the one about
Kong.
Censorship. Yeah, Kong.
Kong.
Yeah, 对，那个字很难念。对 ，Kong.
Okay.
Could I ask just one little follow-up question?
Come on, then.
Okay. What kind of follow-up or following on Wafa's one? Was that all mainly first take? And was the script entirely scripted, or was there some improvisation?
It's all in script, Nothing, in that short film, nothing is improvisation.
And was it all first take?
No. We cherish the first take, but we always... For safety, we always shoot a lot of take. Yeah. I mean, I just shoot it as if we don't have second take. But yeah, actually we do.
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. I think perhaps. Okay. So the next question is. From Dong Lai. So the rise of genre films in Taiwan has been discussed a lot in some of the earlier events. And I would like to learn about your take on the rise of genre film. What kind of genres will become even more prominent? What are your observations as an insider in the industry? Thank you. 这需要翻译吗？
可以的话帮我翻译一下、谢谢。
就是最近很多人就在讨论在台湾就是那个类型电影的崛起。那你对这个就是类型电影有没有什么看法，或者是就是哪些类型会就是日后还会更加的普遍？那你作为这个电影圈的人有没有一些您自己的观察？
我台湾的确最近类型电影崛起是很正常的，因为类型电影它有票房，然后卖的最好的类型电影是恐怖电影，恐怖片。那恐怖片应该会是未来就是一直会在台湾算是每年都会拍很多的一个类型。
好。I think the rise of genre films is a very normal scenario, and I think the most popular genre film right now is horror film, and they'll probably stay popular in the near future, and they tend to make quite a lot of horror films every year.
但是我不敢拍，因为我会做噩梦。
but I don't want to make horror films because I'll probably have nightmares. So I think the next question is from Professor Chris Berry. So would you like to show up and ask a question?
I'm just trying to get myself turned on. Okay, so over the last few weeks when we've had discussions about recent Taiwan film culture, we've been meeting directors, but we've noticed how you guys are all very flexible, very versatile, and you're probably the most extreme example because you're an actor, a director, a producer, a screenwriter. I think also you've even edited some films and so on. So I wonder what your thoughts are about this phenomenon of kind of multitasking, and how do you think about yourself, your own professional identity? You know, if people ask you, what do? You know, how do you answer that question?
Generally, I'll say I'm a director, and but yeah, actually, in my I prefer to be an actor rather than a director. But you know, not so many directors want me to act in their film, so so I have to, you know, make my own film, and yeah. But speaking of multitasking, it's actually I don't think it's a very healthy way for me. But 对不起，我还是需要翻译。 Sorry. 我觉得一次做很多工作其实对我来说不是那么健康，因为它会耗掉我太多的体力跟时间，然后但是我会这么做常常是因为第一个是因为预算的关系，在预算很少的状况之下，我一个人做很多事情可以节省掉很多成本， 不管是沟通的成本或实际的费用成本，先帮我翻译到这里。好，了解。I
think doing multiple jobs at the same time is actually not very healthy for me. It really consumes my energy and time. But I still do that, and the first reason is budget. So if I multitask, I can save budget, for example, in communication, etc.
Yes. 然后，但是它渐渐的成为了我创作的习惯，以至于我现在变成，即便我现在可能会跟别的编剧合作，但是我还是会自己去写剧本。 就是变成是两个人写，或者是最后我还是要重新写一遍。然后，即便我每次剪接都会找另外一个人剪，但我一定会从头到尾自己有一个版本是从头到尾我自己剪过一次。那剪接的部分我等一下再详细说明一次。However,
multitasking has become a habit and an important part of my own creative process. So even though nowadays I work with other script writers, I still like to write the script. So sometimes I co-write or with the script writer, or I write a new version after having a version from the script writer. And also in terms of editing, I also tend to have a version that is edited completely by myself.
在剪接上面，其实我在剪接的时候会，第一个我会在剪接的时候，修演员的表演，就是我会在剪接的时候让所有。 所有的演员的表演趋于某种一致性，并且让演员的不好的部分，或者是不要让他被看到，就是，表演我一直觉得，表演有一半是在剪接的时候才完成的，所以这个工作对我来说是很重要，我必须要在 自己亲手完成那个表演，在剪接的时候。
哦，我尝试一下。
嗯。
Okay, so in the process of editing, I sometimes edit the performance of the actors, and in a way that makes their performance more homogeneous. And in the other hand, I also I don't want the actors to see the bad part of their wounds. So for me, editing actually completes the performance, and editing is a part of performing. And I feel like I want to complete this performance entirely by myself. 好的，谢谢。
嗯，对，没错。然后还有就是关于，我对于节奏这件事情很执着。那我所谓的节奏，其实不是剪接的节奏，而是画面里面流动的节奏。所谓的那个东西很难解释，但是它是看不到的、听不到的某种时间的流动。 那个东西是，常常只有，应该是说那个东西是我有我自己的坚持，关于那样子的时间的流动，所以我也会需要完全的投入剪接，让那个时间的流动在我手中展现出来，才有办法下接下来的工作。
好，我试一试，可能我也担心传达不到你。这个很难翻译，
我知道，对不起。没关系，节奏主要是那个节奏的掌握，但是看不到，我想要掌握的是看不到的节奏。对，所以如果我这个事情交给别的剪接师，他会变成只有看得到的节奏，但是对我来说，我最在意的是那个看不到的节奏，然后那个东西我非常的坚持。
So for me, rhythm is a very, very important thing for me. It's not the rhythm in the process of editing, but the rhythm that is expressed through the flow of time in film. So it's something that can't be seen or heard. I'm very insistent on expressing this flow of time. And the thing is, if I let other people take control of editing, they will make it into something that can be seen. But for me, not being able to see it is more important. That's why I want to take the editing in my own hands.
然后在其他的部分，我也可能有很多部分会自己掌握，例如说制片或者是所谓的制片，就是说自己投资啊，然后或者是在行销上面会参与非常多。 就是，但当然这也是因为我自己投资，所以在行销上面我会，做非常非常多事情，包含行销策略的拟定跟执行，我可能都会自己去做，因为有些部分是我可以自己做的，只要能够透过脸书或 IG 的这种不是非常需要成本的东西，我是可以自己做的。
So apart from editing, there are a lot of parts that I also like to take control in a film. For example, producing the film. I would like to invest in my own film. So to make it more complete, I will also take part in the marketing of my own film. So I'm very I'm very interested in the marketing strategy from planning to carrying out, because, for example, in terms of social media like Facebook or Instagram, it's something that doesn't cost a lot, so I would like to do that by myself. So I also work closely with my colleagues, but I would like to take part in the marketing and the planning. Okay. I think our next question is from our audience, Carol. So Carol is asking about a summer dream, during the Xiaotian. It reminds her of her own experience as a young foreign woman in Taiwan, 1992. So was your actress actually doing the thing when you found her for your film? Did she and many of the other actors have any acting experience? And she's also interested in how you were inspired to create the storyline. Is it from your own perspective as a young man, or is it an interest in the young woman's situation? Yeah. 这个你需要翻译吗？ 就直接翻吧。这位观众很喜欢《死定的夏天》，然后这个就是让他想起来他年轻的时候，作为一个外国人在台湾工作的经验，当时也是大概1992年。那位就是女演员，是你是怎么？ 您怎么找到他的？然后他当时是不是也是在教书？那他还有其他的演员是否也有那个演戏的经验？然后就是说，您是有没有受到什么启发来写出这个作品？然后你的出发点又是怎么样？对，谢谢。好。关于那位女演员。
Manon Garshu， 他是真的就是从魁北克来台湾的学中文的一个算是交换学生，就是跟戏里面没有差别太大。Okay, so
the actress is really from Quebec, and she at that time she came to study Chinese in Taiwan as an exchange student.
好的，然后他不是专业的演员，所以他好像只有拍过《死定的夏天》，之后就我所知好像就没有再演戏了。然后他好像后来就是有做，例如说台湾跟法国，台湾跟加拿大的一些交流的一些工作，对，那他。
在台湾住了蛮长一阵子，好像对，最近才又到欧洲去。您说他在台湾跟加拿大有交流的？没有，他在台湾做一些就是加拿大跟台湾的交流的工作之前嘛，好像是，但对不起，这个部分我不是非常的确定，但是。
他反正在拍完《十天的夏天》之后，他好像也没有继续演戏了。对，他是做别的工作。对。So
she's not a professional actress. As far as I know, Summer Dream is the only film she took part in. And after that film, she did a lot of other work. And for example, some kind of exchange. She worked on some exchange programs between Taiwan and Canada, but she did live for a long time in Taiwan, and afterwards she moved to Europe.
至于那部电影里面其他的演员都那位养阿嬷的演员已经不在了，然后他是一个舞台剧演员，也演了一阵子了，然后另外演男生的那个黄建伟，他是现在已经是一个很有名的演员了，然后一直到现在都还在演戏。
So as for the other actors, the actress who played the grandma is no longer with us now, and she used to be a stage actress, and she did her work mostly in plays, and the protagonist, the young man, is now already an established actor.
然后关于我当初想要拍这部电影的一个想法或动机，其实是，我发觉自己很没有根，我的文化其实是空的。然后那个时候的感觉啦，我那个时候觉得我的文化是空的，我好像很努力在模仿西方的文化，在台湾那个时候。 好像一定要出国留学才是一个成功的一个标准。那我对于这件事情在那个时候是很怀疑的，然后觉得，先翻译到这里好了。了解。
So as for the motivation, for that film. So at that time, I realized I had no roots, and I felt that my culture is pretty much empty. So this is my thought at that time. So people were usually and at that time I had also been trying to imitate Western culture, and that's pretty much the mindset of every young person at that time. And they feel that they must study abroad, and doing that is a mark of success. So I was quite skeptical about that mindset.
然后会去回想那台湾自己有什么跟我自己有什么。 对于那个时候的我来说，这是一个好像是蛮大的一个问题的议题。So
I was thinking about my own roots and the roots of Taiwan, and this was a very big issue for me that I was constantly thinking about.
当然，那个时候那是我二十年前的想法。那这些想法在这二十年有很多的转变。对。So
of course that was my thought 20 years ago, and after 20 years, my thoughts have been undergoing a lot of change. 嗯，okay. Our next question is from our audience, Claire. So, Claire is very interested in your film aesthetic, which seems totally connected to the story you're trying to tell. For example, in Summer Dreams, the extreme close-ups of leaves in a vase, which connect the Canadian girl at the beginning to the Taiwanese girlfriend at the end. Can you explain more about your aesthetic choices? And do these come more from the cinematographer or from the director and storyteller? 那这位观众就是对你的电影美学很有兴趣。那就是他觉得，就是你的美学跟你的 故事其实有直接的联系，就比方说在《石定的夏天》里面，那个就是我们常常看到那个植物，就是一个很 close up 的镜头来对着那个植物，那他觉得这个植物其实把那个加拿大女孩跟最后出现的那个台湾女生就是联系在一起。那你可不可以解释一下你就是你在美学上面的选择，那这些是你的那个摄影师做的决定，还是你作为一个导演还有那个故事就是对你还是您的选择呢？
这是我的选择。然后在关于那株植物，就是其实它是一开始被捡回来的时候，它是没有被放在土里面的，它是放在水里面的，它是那个根是没有着，没有在土里面，然后到最后电影的最后它是放在土里面，其实还蛮好懂的，对还蛮明显的。然后对，那这个是我在剧本的时候就已经写好的，对。然后为了要找那一只植物，其实它不是那么好找，对，要对，那是特别找过的。
OK, so this is my own aesthetic choice. The leaves, as we can see in the film, the leaves were originally put in the water, by the Canadian girl. But when we come to the ending of the film, it was finally put in the soil instead of water. So I think this connotation is pretty obvious. And this is a choice that I've already made in the script writing process.
Okay.
好，那对，然后还有下一个问题就是请问在就是他们在毕业前一天爆炸二里面，那个黄倩他的角色是就是台湾影视作品里面比较就是很少数的那个陆生形象，那请问您当时是怎么想到这个角色和他的故事的，那拍摄过程有没有什么趣事可以分享那我也稍微就问一下，因为就是两个。So this question is about Days We Stare at the Sun Too. So there's a character who's a mainland Chinese student, which is very rare in Taiwan cinematic film work. And so how did you come up with this character? And so is there any interesting anecdote we can share in the process of filmmaking?
好，首先是台湾的一般民众常常对于陆生有一个刻板印象，然后但事实上每一个陆生都不一样，然后我对于这种就是有刻板印象的这样子的事情都非常的敏感，所以的确那时候是有非常有意识的想要让这个角色跟一般大家刻板印象的陆生不太一样。
So I think the general public in Taiwan has a kind of misconception or a kind of stereotype that they put on mainland Chinese students. But I think actually every Chinese student is different. And for me personally, I'm very sensitive to these kinds of stereotypes. And so I was consciously trying to create a different image from this kind of stereotype.
然后关于黄倩这个角色，他是有几个不同的路生，就是说台湾其实有几个像黄倩那样子的路生，那这样的路生其实是真的存在的，他们的想法是，甚至比一些，他可能他甚至有更自由派的想法，对。甚至比一些台湾的学生有的时候还要更偏自由派都有可能，对，所以这样的类似像这样子的想法的路生或会去在事实上在太阳花运动的时候，的确那个时候就有像黄倩这样子的角色的路生在参与太阳花运动的学生媒体的这个部分。
So regarding the character Huang Qian, they actually do exist, and we have actually some Chinese students which are like her, and their mindset is even more liberal than a lot of Taiwan students. So, and we can see those mainland Chinese students participating in the Sunflower Movement as student journalists.
当然，你如果要问这是多数或少数，它当然是比较属于少数，但是它还是存在。然后，我觉得在这样子的状况下，可以换一个角，它可以，因为这个问题其实很敏感。就是关于陆生还有台湾学生，即便他们可能有同样的理念，但是牵扯到民族情感，就是你是台湾人还是中国人的这类似像这样子的民族情感的时候，他就还是会变得很敏感。那我觉得这种敏感的问题，这种。这是真实存在的，而且其实在台湾是关于中国人还是台湾人这样子的所谓的敏感议题是非常非常普遍，而且几乎每天我都会碰到，都会，你知道它是非常普遍的存在。那我觉得没有理由，没有任何一部作品不去提这件事情，那所以对我来说它只是很自然的在描述这个当代的年轻人的时候，我没有想要去回避的一个问题。很复杂，我知道，不好意思。
没关系，没关系，不好意思，我有点担心发音不好。So this is a very very sensitive issue. Regarding Chinese and Taiwan students. In a lot of times, even if they both have the same principles and values, they can still become agitated when it comes to national sentiment. So this is an ongoing and persistent issue. And the question about the cultural identity or national identity of Chinese or Taiwan can be seen and heard basically every day. And for me, I think this is an issue that can't be avoided if we want to talk about young people in Taiwan. And I think then I have to put this issue in at least one of my work. Okay.
然后我再讲，对不起，我再讲一下黄倩这个角色。其实我对我来说，它有一点像是一面镜子。有的时候，透过这么极端的 角色设定可以让可以像一面镜子去看到我们正在做的觉得对的事情。嗯
嗯，
是我们正在做的觉我们觉得对的事情是否真的正确。我的意思就是说它像一面镜子会照射出来一些非常本质的问题，就是例如说太阳花运动到底是为了一个理念，还是它最后是一个民族情感。
Okay, so I want to talk about a bit more about the Chinese student. I think for me, she is like a mirror that reflects the true quality of some issues. And I create such a radical character because I think it can reflect a lot of values. So for example, are we really doing the right thing? So is the sunflower movement, is it purely a movement that is for a principle, or is it something that is more related to the national sentiment? Mm-hmm.
很复杂，对。
嗯，不好意思。
嗯，没关系。
好的。那我们还有一个问题是，那个有个bird whistle 教授。So at one level, this is a film. 就是about do over. At one level, film about filmmaking, and there are many references. To both the process of making films and also to the technology of filmmaking. For example, the close-up shot of sound recording equipment, butt on the lens, and fogging on one edge of the film where it's been accidentally exposed to light. So why is this reflexivity important to you as a filmmaker? 他就是在问关于一年之初的，就是他其实在这个电影里面就用了很多实际反映拍摄过程还有那个技术的镜头，就是比如说那个录音器材的一些 close up 的镜头，还有就是那个有血就是喷出来在那个镜头上，然后还有就是那个边边有一些像雾化的那个效果，应该是就是因为受到强光照射像那个效果。
嗯，
那对对对，那这是不是一个电子的那个效果？然后还有就是，你觉得作为一个电影制作人，这种有点带有反思性的反思性的元素，就是你觉得是不是对你很重要？谢谢。
那个时候的确对于电影这件事情的本质有在有试图想要去挑战看电影这件事情，还有拍电影这件事情的本质，有的确是想要去挑战电影是不是真的，或电影是不是假的，什么是真，什么是假的，这样子的关于电影的本质性的问题。对，先翻译到这里。
好，就是so at that time I was indeed thinking a lot aboutthe nature and process of filmmaking, and so I wanted to challenge this nature of filmmaking. So is what is film real, and what is presented there real?
不只是拍摄这一部分，还有 观看的这一部分，我也那个时候也想要挑战。嗯
，Okay, and not only the filmmaking process itself, but also the process of watching a film. I want to challenge that.
嗯，所以的确那个时候有很多是，就是刻意表现。 电影是假的，或者是刻意有，应该是说刻意让大家知道这是做出来的这样子的东西。
Okay, so at that time, I was indeed trying to demonstrate that what you see on the screen is fake, and film itself is fake, and that this is a very man-made product.
但是那个时候可能希望就是在即便你知道它是假的状况之中，你还可以传达什么，那个还能够传达的东西可能就是真的。那个时候可能是想要挑战这些东西吧。嗯。
So I was hoping to show that even though it's fake, and there is something real that you can convey through that fakeness.
嗯，好，但是那个是我的第一部电影，所以真的野心很大。那可能。 对，可能后来就，野心应该是说野心就摆到别的地方，不会想要去挑战这些东西了。嗯，但是这的确是对于拍电影，喜欢拍电影的人来讲，一个非常可能会做那么一次的事情吧。例如说，在我的心里面，像费里尼的八又二分之一是一个很好的典范。 那或者是，或者是有一部电影叫那个《四肢愈合》的，有一部叫做《下一站天国》，我不知道。那它英文好像是 Wonderful Life， 然后 Koreeda 那个 Hirokaz 的电影，你们知道，就我很喜欢的一部电影。哦，对对对，这部电影。 Koreeda Hirokaz 的那个，考定了，愈合 Hirokaz Koreeda Hirokaz 的 Wonderful Life 是我们那个时候拍 Do Over 之前，我有逼所有的工作人员都要看的电影。
Wafa said it's Afterlife.
Oh, Afterlife 不是 Wonderful Life. Yes. Afterlife. Yes, yes. Koreeda Hirokaz 的 Afterlife. 嗯，那个时候有八又二分之一没有逼大家看，但是那个 Afterlife 有逼所有人看，不是逼所有人看，我就邀请大家一起跟我看。
So Do Over was my very first feature film. And it was a very ambitious attempt. And after that film, my ambition has been placed somewhere else. I think what I did in this film is something that every filmmaker would want to try at least once. And I was very much inspired by Fellini. Eight and a half, if I got that correctly. And also the Japanese director Koreeda, Afterlife. And naturally I forced all the crew to watch that film. Okay.
那我在其实虽然是对于电影的挑战，但其实那也是对于电影的爱。
Okay.
你是说在就是一年之初里面你那个挑战？对，在一年之初，对，在挑战电影的本质这件事情，其实是因为我们都真的很爱电影，所以想要在这上面好好的挑战它一次。
OK. What I did in do-over, so as I said, I was trying to challenge the very nature of film itself. But at the same time, it also my love letter to the medium of cinema.
哇，你翻译的好浪漫。非常好。那就这个问题你是不是讲完了？OK。好的。那下一个问题是Max的问题，那我带他问一下。Was
it a conscious choice to have 他们在毕业前一天爆炸2 more directly focused around recent events in Taiwan rather than issues and character own experience in the first series. So if so, what made you take this approach?
他就是在问你在爆炸二里面，就是更直接的反映当代的事件，然后就是比起第一集来，就是更个人化一点。那你为什么会采取这个做法？因为我那个时候受到一句话的影响很大，就是有一句话说好的电影应该要反映时代，我受到这句话的影响很大，然后在那个时间点。 台湾其实面临非常大的事情，就是太阳花运动前后的事情。那太阳花运动又是一群台湾的年轻人去做的事情，它其实是一个，那个时间的前后，其实是一个非常对台湾来讲非常关键性的时代。但很显然的，一般。 在戏剧作品里面，根本直接跳过这个时代。那我觉得这样子对不起这一群年轻人，对不起这个时代。我觉得好像应该要去拍些什么，去让这个时代留在我们的作品里面，不然以后再过10年，再过20年。 观众回头看以前的作品，你没有，你会在我们的戏剧里面连一部都看不到。再讲太阳花运动，我就觉得这样子很可惜。嗯。
So so my motivation, for that, for the TV series. So I was very much influenced by a quote that. A good film should reflect the contemporary. So at that time, Taiwan was facing a big change, which is the Sunflower Movement. And it is something that is done by young people. And I feel that the time both before and after the movement is a very key change in the whole Taiwan society. However, in most films and series, this very important event is simply omitted. So I think this is a misdeed to the young people and the time that we're facing. And I think it would be a pity if we don't address this issue in my work. And I don't want people to forget about this event because they won't be able to find this event in any of the fiction works that we see.
Okay.
他还是问你会不会有第三季。
不知道 我去找故事，所谓故事来找我就是他就是会在我的脑袋里面出现，那目前还没有第三季出现嘛，但是也许有一天他就会突然出现。
So Max is asking whether there will be a season three for Days We Stare at the Sun. And I think this is simply an uncertainty for me. Because I think earlier I wasn't planning on making a season two of the series, but the story came to find me. It's not that I went and find the story. So I think if there's a right time, I might be motivated to make a season three. So in fact, the story approached me by simply appearing in my head. So yeah, it might happen. I think that's all the questions we have at the moment. Yu, would you like to ask the other questions that you have?
Okay, thank you very much. It's a fascinating Q&A session. I have to say, my second question really is the question I always ask all our directors, because it's reflecting what we are doing here. So if I may, I'll ask the question first in Chinese, then I'll ask English. Okay. 谢谢郑导。 我想问一下啊， 这一次因为我们的电影系列主要是在思考 在新浪潮电影之后台湾电影到底发生了什么事情。 那么作为你作为台湾中生代， 不再是年轻了哈， 中生代这种导演代表之一， 你认为你的作品 因为你今天你早先其实提到了一点点，后来你自己的作品有受到某些影响跟启发，你认为是用什么样的方式被启发到，或者是说你认为你们这一代的人最大的不同是什么？不论是在美学上或题材上或是技术上，有什么样的不同？ Okay, now in contrast to the auteurs in Taiwanese cinemas, directors, you know, would you say that you are influenced by them in one way or another? So to you, what is the biggest difference between you and them? 谢谢。
在台湾新电影之后，其实 我觉得至少还有分两个阶段。那台湾新电影之后，第一个阶段就是像我或林淑宇，或者是魏德胜，或者是严宏雅，我们这几个您刚刚讲到中生代的这一批导演，我们开始拍电影的时候，大概都是西元2000年。 那个时候是台湾电影最糟的时候，就是台湾新电影的已经是最后了，然后台湾一年大概不到20部电影，然后没有人要去看台湾电影，台湾电影如果票房破100万台币就可以庆功了，那个时候是这个状态，麻烦先翻译到这里。
Wait. So you need to turn on your video. Sorry, audio.
Okay, 对不起. So after Taiwan New Cinema, I think there are at least two phases. So the first generation consists of some filmmakers such as myself, Wei Desheng and Lin Shuyu. So we first started making films around 2000, which is probably the worst time for Taiwan cinema. There are less than 20 Taiwan films every year, and no one wants to go to a cinema and watch a Taiwan film. And if a film can make over 100,000
1 million
Taiwan dollars. This is already a case for celebration.
所以在这样子的时代之下。 我们这些年轻导演在那个时候是不被赋予任何期待，我们是纯粹自己想要拍电影，然后开始用16厘米的底片自己开始拍起电影的。嗯，就是说我们有一点像是自己长出来的杂草。So
at that time, no one had any kind of expectation or hope for young filmmakers such as ourselves. And we were like some wild on next to a road. And we pretty much taught ourselves to the art of filmmaking. And we first experimented using this 16mm
films. 但是即便是杂草，我们的脚下还是有土壤，那个土壤就是包含台湾新电影，还有吸收了一大部分的欧洲电影跟美国电影，对。 还有一些日本电影，就是我想像我或林书宇或者是这一代的导演，大部分的养分都来，它都是混合的。So
even though we were wild grass, we still have soil underneath our feet. And that soil includes Taiwan's very own new wave cinema, some European and Japanese filmmakers, and most of our inspiration come from those.
Yeah. 然后，在我们之后的下一个世代，应该说是《海角七号》之后的那个世代。 因为在《海角七号》之后，台湾电影可以赚钱这件事情，导致了很多的资金流入台湾，然后让很多人为了赚钱而开始拍电影。那于是类型电影也，台湾的类型电影也大概是从《海角七号》之后也开始渐渐的发展起来，然后也培养出一批更年轻的导演。 那他们在一开始拍电影的时候就被赋予必须要做到票房回收的这样子的期待，也就是他们必须要拍出一部成功的商业电影这样子的期待。So
what we just talked about is this generation that I'm in. For the generation after us, which is more or less the post Cape number 7 generation. So I think they come from.
对不起，你可能要解释一下那个 Cape number 7 是怎么一回事？它是台湾第一部破亿的台湾电影，就是台湾电影票房破亿。嗯，然后它是赚到非常非常多钱的一部电影，它是。 在台湾电影史上一个绝对没有办法去忽略的一部电影。So
Cape Number 7 is a film that came out in 2008, and it more or less broke the stalemate that Taiwan cinema was facing at that time. So it is the first film that got more than 100 million box office in Taiwan cinema. And it's definitely something that that we have to talk about when we're talking about Taiwan film history. Mm. So so this new generation of filmmakers emerged after Cape Number 7 because this film has actually changed the whole landscape of Taiwan cinema. So because of the money it made and people realized that Taiwan cinema can actually make money, and so a lot of investors to come into Taiwan, and genre films also rose after Cape Number 7, and there's this new generation of younger filmmakers who emerged after Cape Number 7, and they have been given this expectation that they should make a commercial film that can make money.
所以这一批年轻的导演，也许他们受到好莱坞的影响更深，就是他们大概分成两种，一种就是说。 拍的非常类型，非常的，但品质也很高的类型电影，不管是动作、悬疑或者是恐怖电影，他们都会做到非常的高品质的这样子的商业电影，或者是做非常非常台湾本土的一种比较多是喜剧啦，对，台湾本土喜剧的这样子的电影。那因为《海角七号》其实就是所谓的。 第一部就是台湾有那么台湾味的，也可以算是喜剧或比较观众比较看得懂的电影。那所以就后来就产生了很多类似像这样子的，想要制造第二个《海角七号》这样子的电影。所以所谓在《海角七号》之后的两种商业电影形式，就是大概就是。 要么就非常类型，要么就是非常强调台湾本土的这样子的喜剧味的这样子的商业电影，大概是很简单的分，可以分成往这两个方向去走了。嗯。So
there are two major trends after Cape Number 7. So the first type is mostly genre films, and they're generally of quite good quality, and they have a lot of thrillers, action films, and horror films, mostly genre films, but the quality is good. And the second film is a more kind of native and local films that emphasize a kind of Taiwan flavor in the film, and they are mostly comedies. And we can say that Cape Number 7 is the first commercial film that caters to the taste of local audience, and then many films after it would want to try to recreate a second Cape Number 7. So these are the two trends that we see in current film.
所以其实过去的大概20年来，因为从我开始拍电影算 2000年，然后到一直到现在2020年，过去的20年来，其实，台湾电影就是在一个完全不备受期待，跟到后来被赋予非常强烈的商业期待的这么极端的两端在摇摆。但是我的感觉是，今年开始有一个很大的改变。你先翻译到这里好了。嗯，
了解啊，好，我试一下。So in the past 20 years, when I first started making films around 2000, so there has been a very huge change in the Taiwan cinema landscape. So it went from one end of the spectrum to the other end. So before 2000, no one has any expectation for Taiwan films. But in recent years, Taiwan film became a profitable cultural asset again, and people had a lot of expectations for it. So this is how this is the situation right now, which is it went from downhill to uphill.
过去的这海角七号到现在的这一段时间，因为很多热钱的涌入，然后导致有很多的比较但就十部电影里面可能有两部会成功，但是其他的它可能就会是非常粗制滥造的状况。那这样的情形到大概去年2019年开始减少了，原因是因为没有 hot money 了，没有热钱了。那为什么会没有热钱？是因为台湾跟中国大陆的关系越来越不好。在蔡英文上任之后，台湾跟中国大陆的关系越来越不好。然后因为所谓的热钱其实很多都是从中国来的，所以这样子的热钱减少的状况之下，那就没有那么多电影拍了。然后渐渐的台湾在这两年变成回到，我觉得刚好回到一个比较平衡的状态，就是还是有一些台湾的资金会寻求电影，寻求拍摄台湾电影，但是这些台湾电影它越来越精致，然后台湾的观众也越来越可以接受可能比较有议题性的台湾电影，或者是比较特别的台，就是有一点作者论的台湾电影，而不是只接受所谓的我刚刚讲的，就是说比较类型或比较本土喜剧的这样的台湾电影。就是台湾的观众在这几年开始改变了，所以观众改变了，资金也改变了，所以台湾的电影在这两年开始又在做一个新的改变。你这样 OK 吗？听得懂吗？
我努力一下。
好，
可以。
不好意思。
好的。没问题，没问题。So there has been a lot of change, nonetheless, in the last 2 years. So as I just mentioned.A lot of investment came after the success of Cape No. 7. But under that situation, the quality of films would be quite uneven. So maybe two out of 10 films might be successful, but other films were of a lower quality. But starting from around 2019, so there were no more hot money.Because the relation between Taiwan and China has deteriorated. So because there's less hot money and there are also less films to make for the filmmakers. So under this circumstance, a lot of filmmakers still try to make local films. So the films in recent 2 years became more high quality And at the same time, the local audience are more receptive to films with a higher social awareness. And also they are more receptive to auteur films. So in these two years, we see both a change in the taste of audience and the change in the market.
Now, 大的事情, 其实是在台湾电影史里面应该会被记录下来的一个非常大的事情, 在, 就是现在正在发生, 2020年的后半, 那这件事情是因为, 因为疫情的关系, 所以好莱坞电影进不来台湾, 因为好莱坞电影它如果要上映, 它一定是全球一起上映, 那, 现在全世界的疫情都还没有控制下来的状况之下, 好莱坞电影全部都往后延, 所以台湾的戏院没有那么多好莱坞电影了, 那, 但是台湾的戏院还是需要电影, 因为观众想要进戏院看电影, 这时候台湾电影就上场了, 那在2020年的后半, 好多部台湾电影都, 票房都非常的好, 包含我自己拍的那个Dear Tainan 的票房都超出以往的好, 就照理来说, 像Dear Tainan 这种那么作者的电影, 就是郑有杰拍的电影, 怎么可能票房那么好, 所以这个是在以往很难想象的, 那这代表就是说, 台湾的观众已经做了很多改变了, 那不只是Dear Tainan, 最近还有一部叫《无声》, 它是讲一个台湾的聋哑学校的性侵事件的这样的电影, 这样的电影在以往也不可能票房很好, 但它现在已经票房到4-5千万, 然后像, 刻在你心底的名字, 这是一部, 同志电影, 同志爱情电影, 它票房也快要破亿了, 然后最近才刚上映的一部叫《孤味》, 台湾的新的电影叫《孤味》, 它是一个, 年轻导演拍的第一部电影, 然后这一部是我觉得非常非常, 也是以往比较没有的台湾电影, 它是一个真的非常在地的一部商业台湾家庭电影, 但是它不是像过往那种, 非常夸张的喜剧, 而是很写实的台湾的家庭的电影, 那它是一部商业电影, 然后票房也非常非常好, 可能也会破亿, 那以往这样子的电影很难破译, 那但是今年一部分因为疫情的关系, 另外一部分因为, 导演应该创作者和观众两边都成长了不少, 所以, 这些电影都可以有很好的成票房, 至少在票房上面有很好的成绩, 对。好，我知道很多, 但是你, 你大概可以吸收我的大概那个意思, 就是说现在2020年后半年在台湾发生正在发生一个非常大的事情, 这个是有别于以往的,
我了解，我试一下，可是可能要请你帮我一下那个懒。So in fact, a very huge change is currently taking place in Taiwan. Actually, the latter half of 2020. So I think this is a big change that would probably go down in the film history of Taiwan. So this event is the COVID-19. So because of the pandemic, the Hollywood films were being held off and they couldn't come in and yeah, a lot of the releases of Hollywood films were being postponed. And so there were less Hollywood films in cinema, but still the audience in cinema demand films. So this is why Taiwan films have flourished. So and commercially, so a lot of films have done very, very well in box office, including my own film, The Attendant. So in recent years, this is a situation that is very hard to imagine, because this is more like an auteur film. So this also shows that the audiences have changed a lot in their taste. So in recent months, a lot of films such as Wusheng, The Silent Forest, which is a film about sexual assault in a disability center, and also Little Big Women, which is a commercial film, but more like a realist film about family issues. So all of these films have done very well in box office. So I think there are two reasons to this phenomenon. So the first one is, of course, COVID-19. And the second one is that I think both filmmakers and audiences of Taiwan have matured a lot. So I think this is why Taiwan cinema is in a very good state now.
Good. 对，就是我们也不知道在明年会变成什么样子，但是至少现在看到的状况是一个非常非常巨大的转变。那我以数据来讲的话，台湾已经像今年这个月发生一件事情，就是说曾经有一个礼拜，台湾的电影院里面的前五名的票房，就票房前五名里面有四部都是台湾电影，这个已经是二三十年没有的事情。通常你会前五名的票房通常都是大部分都是那个好莱坞电影，可能只有一两部是台湾电影，但是上个月有发生了这样的事情，就是前五名有四部都是台湾电影。
I can't tell how the situation will be next year, but I can tell you from the facts and figures that we have. So I think there's 1 week in this month where four out of the five highest grossing films in Taiwan cinema are Taiwan films. So this is a situation that's previously unheard, because usually the highest grossing films are always the Hollywood films, and perhaps maybe one or two Taiwan films will become successful, but now the situation is very, very different.
那我们不知道这样的情况它到底是只有暂时的，还是它会做一个很大的改变，但是至少在2020年的现在，它是一个就是一个非常特别的一个现象。
So I don't know if this is a temporary phenomenon, or it will be a more permanent situation, but I think at least in 2020 it is a very unique phenomenon that would go down in history.
谢谢。
Okay. Right. Wow. On that promising note, I think, you know, it's solid 2 hours of talking. It's fantastic. I think we can see the clock at the back of Director Zheng's room. It's almost 12. So, you know, it's a midnight. Okay. On that note, I think we should wrap up today's session. But thank you, Yu-Chieh, for giving us so much insight into your filmmaking career and sharing so many your way of seeing and also creating process. This amazing experience to have, so rare as well. We really look forward to screening your new films, I'm sure, in not too distant future. And I wonder whether we can invite you back next time. Is that okay?
Of course.
Is that a promise?
It's my honor. It's my honor.
Oh, fantastic. Okay. So what I'll do now, what I'll do is I have just unmuted everyone. So everyone can switch on their microphone. And can I ask you, can I ask you to put your hands together and thanks, Youjie. Thank you very much. And put your hands together. Yeah?
Right. Thank you.
Brilliant. Thank you so much.